Well, welcome to the Arizona Mining Review. It's March 26, 2018. I'm your host, Mike Conway, and we're here today in the offices of Arizona Mining Incorporated in Tucson with Chief Operating Officer Don Taylor. And Don's going to tell us about the world-class Taylor Zinc, Lead, and Silver deposit in the Patagonia Mountains of Santa Cruz County in southeastern Arizona. And to give you an idea of just how the magnitude of the Taylor deposit, Don was just awarded the prestigious Thayer Lindsay Award for Best Global Discovery at this year's PDAC convention in Toronto, Canada. Don, welcome to the Arizona Mining Review. And let me start off by congratulating you on the Best Global Discovery. That's quite an accomplishment.
Great. Thanks, Mike. Yeah, it's pretty special. There's no doubt about it. And, you know, it's good for Arizona mining. It's good for the state of Arizona. It's brought some notoriety, you know, to the project that we didn't otherwise have.
Right.
And so, yeah, it's certainly a good win for everybody.
Excellent. And before we move into that, I know that you're a product of the University of Missouri at Rolla. Tell us a little bit about your mining history, your mining background.
We've been in the business longer than I care to think, but yeah, I started out at Southeast Missouri State with some great professors there, and then moved on to the University of Missouri, Rolla. Great education there. And so I worked in the business both underground, open pit, exploration, development, and mining, and so I've had a good wide range of experience in my career, and so worked for some of the big companies and worked for some of the small, and certainly found a home here at Wildcat Silver, now Arizona Mining, and happy to be here.
And I remember about a decade ago, Wildcat Silver was maybe just beginning to work, and they were looking at a very large manganese silver deposit, and then you come on board, and the next thing I hear is that, well, this is really a world-class zinc, lead, and silver deposit you're looking at. So what's the story behind that?
Well, I came on in 2010, and mainly because I saw a situation where I could make the oxide deposit a lot bigger. Originally, it was about 50 million contained ounces of silver.
Okay.
It now holds somewhere between 180 and 280, depending on how you calculate it. And we haven't given up on the oxide deposit because a couple of things. One, it is a world-class deposit in its own right.
Yeah.
150 million ounces contain silver. But the other thing that's important about it is that 100% of the manganese that's used in the United States comes from abroad. It's all imported. So manganese is on the critical mineral list, and so we're pushing that forward. It doesn't have the mass to it right now that the sulfide deposit has. And obviously the sulfide deposit has dwarfed it in size. And, you know, we're approaching certainly world-class status for the sulfide deposits. And so it's a good story all the way around.
Right.
But I think the one thing that people will, I think, remember about the deposit long after certainly I'm gone is that, you know, it's a multi-generational mine.
Right.
It's going to produce minerals that the United States needs for many, many decades to come.
Mm-hmm.
The oxide deposit itself is probably a 70-year mine life.
Wow.
The sulfide deposit right now, we're certainly exceeded 30.
Yeah, right.
But it could be as much as 60 or 70 years as well.
And that's an old mining district, because I think that was discovered in the 1870s or something like that. It worked probably for silver and zinc at that point in time.
Originally silver, and date back to the middle 1880s.
Okay.
The town of Harshaw, which is just literally within a mile of the project, was a town of 2,500 at the turn of the last century. And so we've seen manganese, lead, zinc, and silver production out of the district for almost 150 years now.
Right.
During World War II, they actually mined it for the manganese because they needed to produce steel.
Yeah, right.
And so we've seen a lot of activity in the district, and no place better to find a big deposit than when there already is some activity on
it. Yeah, and Arizona's got some nice manganese deposits. There's one out by the Artillery Mountains as well.
Yeah.
And during World War II, that was worked again, and material was sort of stored someplace, but I don't think they ever brought it into full production. I don't think they ever got what they wanted out of that. So what kind of mining are we talking about here?
It's going to be an underground mine, so small surface footprint.
Yeah.
You know, and one of the great things about what we're doing is, you know, we've had a chance to kind of sit back and think about things. And so what we do is we employ nothing but best practices, and they call it Bad Cat. It's prescriptive best practices. So our tailings will be dry stack, so no tailings ponds.
Good.
If not more than 50%, certainly 50 to 60% of our tails will go back underground, and we'll use it as, plan is to use it as structured backfill.
Okay.
Two things happen when you do that. One is you recover more water, so you know, less water consumption.
Right.
The other thing is less surface impact.
Yeah.
And then thirdly, and maybe even more importantly, is you get maximum use of the ore body, so we get maximum extraction by using that old material, that tailings material, to structure backfill. So it's going to be a nice small footprint deposit,
right.
Very low surface impact, very low environmental impact overall. And so you can do a lot of things with underground mining you can't do with these large open pits.
And and you're right. I mean, of course, the environmental impacts are considerably less than the open pits.
Absolutely,
so,
very
good. Processing of the ore on site, or we take it elsewhere and get it processed? You've got a railroad line, Union Pacific or something, pretty close to you?
Pretty close, yeah. What we will do is at site, mm-hmm. we'll mine the ore and we'll mill it on site.
Okay.
And we'll make two concentrates. We'll make a lead concentrate. And the lead concentrate will run about 1.5 kilograms of silver. And we'll make a zinc concentrate, and it'll run about 300 grams per ton of silver. Both those concentrates will be shipped out to various smelters around the world.
Okay.
We'll make enough concentrate that one smelter couldn't take them all.
Yeah.
So they'll be distributed throughout the world to some of the smelters around the world.
Right. So that's a big project, just moving in, transporting that material and getting it smelted.
And again, we're looking at some really innovative technology on how to do that.
Oh.
Slurry pipelines, potential for moving cons, so keep trucks off the road.
Yeah, right.
Obviously, the things that bother people in local communities is air, water, and traffic.
Exactly.
So we're trying to address those. We don't think any of those, but we know the air and water are not going to be an issue. Traffic,
right.
There's only so much you can do.
Right.
But we will get it on a truck and get it to a railhead as soon as possible to make it more efficient.
And for Santa Cruz, the economics of this is a big, big deal. Because you're looking at bringing in a number of people and also, if I take it, hiring locally. How many people do you think will be working there when you guys are going full bore?
During construction, and again, this is just a sulfide deposit, but during construction,
right.
it'll be about 800 people on site. Today, we're somewhere between 200 and 300.
Okay.
We're the largest employer right now in Santa Cruz County.
Yeah.
Steady state, the numbers show right now about 525 steady state employees, direct employees. We've just commissioned and got it, and I don't have all the numbers in front of me today, but we're still fact checking it. But Arizona State just did an economic impact study on what the project will have on not just the communities,
but
Southern Arizona and Arizona as a whole.
Yeah.
And it's a pretty impressive report. Yeah, it's the downstream is huge.
Yeah.
In terms of jobs and support.
Yeah, that's excellent. I'm sure that the folks in Santa Cruz, the county authorities are pretty happy to see something like this, because they've not had much to be cheerful about in the last couple of decades.
It's amazing how many tax dollars will come back to, not just through employee taxes,
right.
but through state taxes and federal taxes as well, how much of that comes back to the state of Arizona.
Yeah.
And we've taken a very, the right thing to do is, like 85% of the people that we hire, we hire them as local as we can.
That's great.
And I don't know the current numbers, but 93% of the money that we had spent up to the end of last year was spent in Southern Arizona.
Wow.
The only exception to that were things that simply we couldn't get done.
Yeah.
One of them was a metallurgical test work we had to do in Canada, and it was expensive.
Yeah.
But we hire local, and we support local. So that's just a philosophy that we employ.
Well, I'm sure the people there will appreciate that, because there are a lot of kids down in the area growing up, and there's not a lot of opportunities for jobs and jobs that pay well, and mining usually does. You guys are you're fortunate in that you're largely on either small slot of patented land, but you're then on private land, so you don't have the problems that, say, HUD Bay has had with Rosemont, where you're dealing with the federal government and you have to have environmental impact statements. So that'll move you forward a little quicker than they would.
It will. We still conform to all the things that we would do on federal land.
Sure.
So we've spent millions of dollars on background studies in terms of the bugs and bunnies, so the environmental studies.
Sure.
Groundwater studies, we've done all of those. And, we're going to be a good corporate citizen no matter how this works out, whether on federal land or private land.
But
we are fortunate in two things. One, with the underground mining activity, smaller impact on surface.
Right.
So we're able to facilitate that, move it around on the private lands that we do have.
Mm-hmm.
And all the permitting that we've done so far has been with the state.
Okay.
And I got to tell you, they have been wonderful to work with. The agencies there, especially ADEQ. Well, it's very businesslike.
Yeah.
Very responsive, very transparent. And so far, it's just absolutely worked wonderful for us. And as I mentioned, if you employ bad CAD or best prescriptive practices, it makes their job easier, it makes our job easier.
Yeah.
And if there's nothing better you can do, it's hard to ask for that, right?
Yeah, so, exactly.
Anyway, it's worked very well for us, and it is going to allow us to accelerate the project by quite a bit just by being on private lands.
Very good. Now, one sort of, I'm getting to the end of this, but each year, Arizona competes with Nevada to be the number one non-fuel mineral production state in the country. Are you guys going to put us, we're always coming in at number two. Are you guys going to put us over the top, or are we going to be number one?
We'll be very, very close. Okay. Yeah, because I think it goes on value, on revenue.
It does.
And we might not make it for the first couple of years, but in the third year of operation,
okay,
we'll be at full production at that point, and it's a lot of revenue dollars. So it should push us ahead of Nevada.
Good to know. Is there anything that I haven't asked that you'd like to address?
No, it's gratifying to be a part of something that you know is going to affect a very large number of people, multi-generational.
Right.
And I think Arizona will come to enjoy the small footprint and the success that we'll see at Hermosa. So anyway, no, that's all. I mean, it's just a good